Hello, and welcome to SoberCast, where we provide AA speaker meetings and workshops in podcast format. We're an ad-free podcast, and if you enjoy listening, please help us be self-supporting by visiting SoberCast.com, look for the donate link, and drop a dollar or two into our virtual basket. We hope you enjoy the podcast. Have a great day.
Hi, I'm Amy, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hi, Amy.
Hello. My story. Well, I grew up in a small Texas town that was in a dry county. It was your typical Friday night lights. I lived that life. And the two goals as a teen were to go to all the football games and how could we find alcohol and buy it underage. I began drinking a little bit when I was in the eighth grade. And I really ramped up hard January of my ninth grade year. And my father, my parents had a rocky relationship where my father, he had so many struggles, so many inner struggles. That was what he did. And my mom tended to spend time trying to keep everything together. And December the 6th of 1981, my father took his own life. And he was, I don't like to say he was an alcoholic, because I don't know. And it was always his responsibility to say that. But I really believe that he struggled deeply with alcohol and demons in his heart. And his timing really was bad. The whole thing just crushed me. It was like someone took a knife and just stabbed my soul, and everything in it just ran out all over the ground. My ability to love with a genuine heart, my ability to hold on to anything. It was hard. And as all of you, I'm sure, that have had a loss can understand that. And that was really when I was off to the races with my drinking. And in order to protect myself, I decided that anger was the only emotion that I was allowed to feel anymore because it kept me safe. And that was a dumb idea. But so I went through many years of rebelling and drinking hard and I never got in any trouble with the law, except I got an MIP when I was 15 and it was $38. And, you know, it didn't hurt. And so I drank and drank and drank, and I guess the worst behavior I had was I set my car on fire, the back seat of my car, when I was 15. And so the fire department, you know, it was kind of a big deal in a small town. And a year after that, I set the front seat of my car on fire. And so I had a lot of behaviors that were very representative of you know, the idea that something's not going right here. And I went off to college, and I went to the top rodeo college in the state of Texas. And it was not the right place for me to be. And I was just wandering aimlessly and empty. And the only way I could fill my soul was with alcohol. And it would go in, and then it would come out of those open wounds. And so it was never full. And I moved back home after 2 years of college, and had a, you know, marriage that didn't work. Your typical, you know, my life was very typical. And I divorced, and I'd always gone to a church camp as a child. And I think that was my saving grace, was that I had that. And I was reconnected after my divorce with this group of people from church camp. And they began to say, help me patch up my soul. And I'm actually married to one of them now. And so he was my second saving grace that was given to me by my first saving grace, which was God that sent me to camp. My drinking went on for over 30 years, and it ebbed and flowed, and it ebbed and flowed. And, you know, we moved to New Orleans. We married. We lived in Austin. And we moved to New Orleans. And that was a lot of fun. It was a fun place to be. You know, I rode in a parade. You had to tie yourself on to the float. And I mean, it was just, you know, I fell, you know, it was a fun, fun time. And I was going through graduate school, and I really, I had to half measure it through graduate school so that I could continue my drinking career. And, you know, honestly, to this day, my drinking career was the longest, most successful career that I've ever had. And that's kind of, when you think about it, I'm like, okay, well. And so I had a child, and we decided after we had our child that New Orleans was really not the place for us to be. And so we moved a year prior to Katrina. And so we moved back to Texas, and I was still drinking. And that was, I guess I began to try to get sober in Austin. And then I began to, you know, and it was like, you know, it was a piecemeal. And then we moved to New Orleans, and I tried again to get sober several times. And I just never could, I couldn't piece together even a month. And so we moved back to Texas, and one of my dear friends, who oddly enough is here tonight visiting from camp, she was in the program. And so she kind of took me in and helped me to start to, you know, understand a little bit more about what the program was about. But I was not ready. I didn't understand. I would read the book and I got nothing out of it because I wasn't ready to open my heart enough and open that door in my soul to let the goodness flow back inside of me. And, time went by. We moved we ended up in Seattle, which was something that never really crossed our minds. I had never even been to Seattle, until we moved here when my husband began working with Amazon. We had our one child, and when we moved here, I almost immediately got pregnant again. And so we had these two babies, and childbirth was not easy for me. I almost died in my second childbirth. And, so we decided that was enough kids for us. And my inability, you know, my soul, it was yearning. My soul was hurting. I had these two beautiful children, and I was overwhelmed trying to raise them. And that was really when my alcoholism just like went up the mountain. And I was a silent but vicious drunk. You know, I didn't go out and drink. I didn't. I stayed home, and I could put away a bottle of wine or more, you know, every night. And I had these two young children, and I was able to, I could keep it together. I guess I was functioning, as it were. And my body started to show signs. My health started to decline, which we really think when I was pregnant, that was, my body was having issues from drinking. And so my doctor, I went to the doctor, had blood work done, you know, cholesterol. And he sat down with me and he showed me a couple of years of my blood work. And he said, you know, Amy, he said, you know, he's going over it with me. And he said, do you think you have a problem with alcohol? And I mean, I'd known for years that I had a problem with alcohol, and I could not, you know, I would go to meetings and I would not go to meetings, but I could not verbally express, you know, that I did. It was all here, but everyone around me knew it. It was like the elephant in the room. And so I looked at him and said, well, you know, if you think that, then and have enough evidence to present that with me, then I suppose. Yeah. Okay. You win. And I have to give that some thought. And, and I had lost, that was in May, and then June, I lost one of my dear friends in Texas to alcoholism. And, so I knew it was like in May, and I don't work fast. And, unless I was drinking. And so I decided I would think about it over the summer and kind of get used to the idea and kind of wean myself. And I had never really been able to wean myself very well. And I had only piecemealed together a month of being sober prior to that. And I worked on it and worked on it and thought about it. And I prayed about it. And I began to diminish those gin and tonics and bottles of wine. And we went on a trip. And I decided, okay, my August 25th. I'm like, I've been sober since August 25th of 2014. And so that was going to be my date. And I was very calculated in choosing it because it's my sister's birthday. And I wanted to be able to say to her when she was 50 that I was one. And so it was just this thing. We have that kind of relationship. And so I stopped drinking. And I began going to meetings, and I met a very feisty, very dedicated woman in this program who really began to actually help me to open up that soul, and just, you know, through people that I was meeting in the program, just slowly we were stitching together all those holes. And it was very emotional for me. I mean, I hadn't cried in 30 years because I was pissed off, and that was the way I operated. I didn't cry. You know, I just stuffed and stuffed and stuffed. And when I became sober and piecemealed more than a month, I began to understand what all of this meant, and began to realize that this is real. And this is what I was reading. I began to understand, and my soul began to heal. And all of a sudden I became very emotional, and then all of a sudden I couldn't stop crying. You know, I would go to the grocery store and I'm crying. You know, I walked around with Kleenex all the time because I never knew when it was going to come rolling out. And it was as if I felt like my soul had been patched up, but all the stuff that all this stuff now was coming out of my soul, and that had been empty. And it was very confusing for me. And it was very embarrassing for me too, because having gone so long without being able to cry, and that's a huge part of my story. It was cleansing. Once I got past being embarrassed, walking through the grocery store crying, I realized I was just walking through life, and I was cleansing, and I was, you know, I was sober, and all of this stuff was escaping out of me, and it was overwhelming. And, you know, when I went through that with my doctor, talking with him about being sober, you know, my father shot himself. So I always said, no matter what, I'm never going to do that to my children, ever, you know, because I had felt that pain. I'm like, that is the last thing I want to do to the people that I love more than anything and cherish in my life. And what I realized was with alcohol, I was doing that. It was just a really slow process. And so now, you know, I am sober. I feel so much better. I am going back to work. I can function in my home. I can love my children with a genuine whole heart. I don't get aggressive. I still get angry, but, cause that's, I think that's life, but, I feel like I am there for my children. And, this past year has been a challenge. It's really challenged my ability to be sober. And it's not like I ever felt like I wanted to drink through this last 2 years, but, a year and a half ago, my beautiful daughter, Claire, decided that we found out that she's Matt. And so we began going through the process of working a transgender child through that system. I thought, oh, this is great. You're transgender. Okay, we're going to walk through this. There's a lot of stuff. There's a lot of stuff, you know, just all the things that you go through. And it was really hard for me. It still is hard for me. But I can be a mother that shows up. I'm a mother that sits with him and takes him where he needs to go. And I can support him 100,000%. And, you know, that matters to me. And with my younger daughter, I have been able to do the same thing through her sadness about losing a sister, and my husband losing a daughter, and, you know, embracing a son at the same time. It is really... It's an interesting and fabulous journey for us. And I would not be able to do it. I stop and think about, you know, if it hadn't been for this program to help me understand my inside and my deep love, but my inability to let it out. If it hadn't been for that, from, you know, my child going through that and me getting sober, I think that has really deepened my soul. It has deepened what is inside of me, and it has helped me to become the person I need to be. And that is, I never realized I could feel so happy and so real and so proud. It never occurred to me before, and I didn't like myself before. And It's the greatest feeling. I mean, I'll be crying, but I feel so full of joy. I mean, it's the weirdest thing to me because it's foreign for so many years to have drank. And now I'm learning this and I feel like it's a new beginning, even 2 years and 7 months into this. I am still growing. I'm still learning. I'm at peace most of the time. I think having children anyway is amazing. And, I'm doing good and I'm happy for that. Thank you all.
My name's Bob. I'm an alcoholic. My home group is the last chance group of Alcoholics Anonymous, which meets Friday evenings in Greenwood. My sobriety date is June 10th, 2014, which is 3 years, 1 week, and a day ago today. And Laura Lee asked me to give you my take of what it was like, what happened, and what it's like now. And I'll start with what happened. 3 years, 1 week, and a day ago, I was wheeled into the Faulkner Hospital in outside of Boston, Massachusetts. I couldn't walk, have neuropathy in my legs, and I was beaten up enough that several days later that the people in the hospital kept asking me what happened, who did this to me, because I was that beaten up. I was starting to hallucinate. I was vomiting. I couldn't walk, and that was when my sobriety was suspended, and I didn't decide not to drink that day. To this day, I've never decided not to drink. When I was going into the hospital, when I was admitted to the Faulkner, I was hallucinating. I was the doctor told my buddy that brought me in that if I hadn't gotten there that day, I probably would have been dead in 2 days. I don't remember this. I was unconscious and I was in bad enough shape that the Faulkner didn't keep me. They couldn't keep me there. They shipped me to a hospital in downtown Boston. They sent me to Brigham and Women's. And I was intubated and I was in the ICU for several days. That's where I woke up. But I knew before I was intubated that my drinking days were over. It wasn't a decision I made. If anybody asked me now, I've never decided to stop drinking. It was a decision that was made for me. I really can't say I was responsible for it. But that's what happened. And shortly thereafter, I totally stopped. I totally turned my life around, and I left Boston. I came out here and started anew. But the story of what happened to me or how I got that way is I'm an alcoholic, and I've always been an alcoholic. I was born an alcoholic. I remember the first time I drank alcohol. I was it was in the 70s, early 70s. I was skiing, and my sister and I had come in from skiing, and we were frozen solid, and we were crying because our fingers and toes were warming up, and my mother gave us wine. She's like, it'll make your toes and fingers stop hurting, and it did. And so, I mean, I know that the first time I drank for effect, and it worked. It made my toes stop hurting. I also know that, like, as a kid, like in the 70s, I got, like, as a Christmas gift, little airplane bottles of booze. I used to do that in the 70s. So as a little kid, I got, like, a little green bottle of booze and a little red bottle of booze and a little clear bottle of booze. And as a, like, 10-year-old kid, I made a bar in my closet, in my bedroom. And even at that day, I think I was hoarding it. I think I was, like, you know, oh, am I, you know, hiding this? Like, so that was my first time I think that I was, that, you know, that I, when I look back, I'm like, well, that's alcoholic behavior through and through. And a lot of my decisions through life have been, whether I was drunk at the time or not, they were just alcoholic decisions. And I still do that now. And that's something I sort of have to deal with. But I, the first time I ever got shut off was drinking wine at Christmas Eve at home, because that's, you know, drinking wine, calm down, little kids. But that being said, it sounds like I'm blaming my parents for my alcoholism, which isn't true. I'm an alcoholic. Alcoholism runs on my both sides of my family. I've never met my mother's only brother because he's a hillbilly, lives in Appalachia, and he's off the grid. And that's the kind of alcoholism that runs in my family, like pretty hardcore. So, you know, that's the way it is. And growing up, you know, as a high school kid, I was the kid that liked the party. You know, we probably all like that, you know, to a certain extent. I was always in low-grade trouble. By the time I got out of high school, I'd been arrested a couple times. I'd been in handcuffs. I'd been in the backseat of a police car. I'd walked downstairs to my kitchen table, and there's a police car, there's a policeman sitting at my kitchen table. Been through all that stuff. Went to college. Same kind of thing. Just much more partying. More trouble with the law. My first DWI, drinking 151 straight out of the bottle will do that to you. One car accident. Gee, I wonder what. Another example of I wasn't drinking the second time I got arrested in college, but you're not supposed to smoke pot in airports. It'll get you in trouble. It was before 9/11, but still, like. And so it just continued that way. When I graduated from college, most of my college buddies, they went back to sort of, you know, they went back to the towns they grew, you know, they came from, or they got married and had kids. And for me, I didn't do that. Like I stayed in Boston. I'm like, this party's not over. You guys are going to live your lives and, you know, have careers and stuff. It's not for me. And so, I started working, but my career, the jobs I had, never got the traction professionally that I should have, because in retrospect, you know, I was partying, you know, we were all young and we were all partying, but the people that I worked with, they were studying, you know, I work in engineering, you know, they would go home and study for professional exams. And I had none of that. And I'm like, I'm partying. And that's the way it went for like way too long. Same thing with relationships. Like I've been lucky to be involved with a number of like really great girls, but I never thought about the future at all. I mentioned I went to school in Boston. I picked Boston because there was four college brochures on my kitchen table, and when I was in high school, my mother was hectoring me about, you got to pick where you're going to go to school. I had a buddy coming over, and it was Friday night. We were going out partying, and my mother's bugging me about the future, and I don't want to hear any of it. So I was like, there, I'm going to that school. And off I went, and I stayed there for 30 years. I don't regret it, but that's what drove that decision. This is the drive-in. It's going to start. We got to go. And like I said, the same thing with relationships. Like, partners don't like that. Partners, you know, especially back in those days, you know, they're thinking about getting married. They're thinking about having kids. They're thinking about other things. And I wasn't. And so, you know, I still in touch with some of these women today. They're married. They have kids. They have houses. They have all those kind of things. I just wasn't in that kind of place. And so it probably came to a head a few years ago. I was involved with a woman, and we've been going pretty well. And she told me one night, she was like, "I think we should move in together." And we were at a nice Mexican restaurant, and there was like homemade sangria, and it was like just the right kind of buzz, you know, when you're like, it's that you rarely ever get there, but it's just the right kind of buzzed. And she mentions that she thinks we should move in together. And I had done that previously when I was younger, and I said I'd never do that again. But I knew right then and there, I was like, I'm not going to stop drinking, and this is going to be a problem. And if I'd been an adult, if I'd been a man, if I'd been not an alcoholic, I hopefully would have said, this isn't going to work. But I didn't do that. I said, yeah, let's move in together. And I put her through 6 years of hell. And that is my biggest regret, that I can't give her those years back. I can do a lot of things, but I can't give her those years back. And I knew from the get-go that I was making a mistake, and I did it anyway because I'm a selfish person. And that is one of the things that sort of defines me as an alcoholic, and probably all of us. And that really came to a head when after she moved out, because you know that's the way it was going to work out. And so I got this job. I got this part-time job. It wasn't supposed to be a part-time job. It was supposed to be a part-time to a full-time job. But over the course of 5 years, I was there for 5 years. But it ended up, I didn't have a boss. I didn't have real defined hours. All I had to do was get things done. And the girlfriend had just moved out. And so for like 5 years, I just started to drink a little bit more each day. I would drink before work. I drank before work every day for 5 years, like 5 o'clock in the morning. You know, I would pass out early at night, like a lot of us did. And so I'd wake up in the morning, 4 o'clock. I'm like, I don't have to be at work until, well, I can be at work whenever I want to. So I would start drinking 3, 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the morning, vodka and coffee. And I knew all the liquor stores that opened at 8 o'clock, so I could stop on the way to the store. I mean, on the way to work. I would never have really any responsibilities. I'd go drinking at lunch. I'd get nips at lunch. I knew all the liquor stores on the way back. I'm stopping at the liquor stores on the way back. And things just got, you can understand, worse and worse and worse. And what happened when it really came to an end was it had gotten so bad, I was just sitting in my apartment drinking. And I mentioned I had neuropathy in my legs, and I drank so much that I started to fall down. And I also started to knock off liquor bottles off of my little coffee table. So there's broken glass on the floor because I'm drunk and I don't clean it up. And I got a second DWI around this time too, which I didn't even know that I got a DWI until I missed the court date, because that kind of stuff happens when you're an alcoholic. So lost my train of thought. But so I had this job, and there's broken glass all over the floor. I start to fall down, and one day I'm staggering around. I fall down onto broken glass. This is how I get bruises. I get cuts. I decide, not sure what to do. Climb into the bathtub, because that's what I'm going to do or something. And then I realize I'm drunk. I can't get out of the bathtub. And so I decide to pass out there. I wake up in the morning, and a few hours later, I'm in a bathtub. I'm covered with blood, and I realize I'm wet because I'm also covered with urine. And that's what it was like for me. People talk about high bottom drunks, low bottom drunks. That's what it was for me. If I was to drink again, that's where I am again. I'm in a bathtub, bleeding, covered with my own urine. And so that's what it was like. So then very shortly thereafter, I ended up in the hospital, and my family decides that I can't go back to that apartment, that I have to completely change, come out here, move into my brother's house, get sober, right away start go to my last chance group, which this is still my home group. And that's when it was pointed out to me that my interest in drinking really has been lifted, which is, I mean, you guys just heard that story. The fact that I really don't think about drinking at all. It's just a gift. I don't have drinking dreams. I don't think about it. It is pretty remarkable that is the case. And as I go through this, through this sobriety thing, I started going to Last Chance. And one of the first things, you know, that struck me is you hear all these stories from other people that are sharing these common stories that you just can't believe that person is sharing your exact same story, even though they're completely different. And so, you know, that began to creep into my world. That's about the time when it became apparent to me that I have a higher power that's influencing these things. As professionally, as a sober person, I had all these kinds of like crazy tumults. I've been fired twice in sobriety. I quit the same job twice for exactly the same reason. I think that reason is because this higher power, I just had a full year that I just didn't get it right. So life being life just said, try it again, Bob. And so it was like a groundhog year. But, you know, apparently it was sort of required. So I, you know, learn these things. So as I go along now I'm like 3 years sober, I still kind of feel like this. It's this weird, like crazy, agitated sort of thing. And for a long time, I had a real hard time finding a job. I was very close to being homeless for a short period of time. But one of the things I learned is that that when I was that close to homeless, there was people in Alcoholics Anonymous that offered these, you know, if they said, if it comes to that, you can stay at our house. You know, we're not going to let that happen to you. And I know these people, and I know their house, and they don't have room, but they still offered. And It didn't come to that, but in the back of my mind, you bet I knew it. That, you know, that it's probably, you know, if it really gets that bad, I'm probably not going to end up in the street. But so, you know, it's been a slow step. I don't really struggle with not drinking that much, but it's the whole living a sober life is very difficult to me. I had my boss pulled me aside like 2 weeks ago, and you know, I'm just very short tempered and snapping at people. And he pulled me aside and he was like, you can't do that anymore. You're not going to be working here. And so that's when I realized there's so much more to this sobriety thing than just not drinking. And so I have to focus on that. I'm just about done, Steve. I heard that. But I have to, when I started this job in December, that's all I did for since then. I've probably taken 10 days off total since that time. And it's too much. So I have to be a more full person. I can't just be the guy that works hard and the guy that doesn't drink. You know, I have to embrace AA more, which is why I'm here. I've never been to this meeting before, but the AA powers that be put me here, and I'm thankful for it. So it's good. So I have to. That's my sober. The next hurdle is being more than just a person that doesn't drink and a person that tries not to get fired. That's what I'm going to do. I have to take these concrete steps, and doubling down on sobriety is one of them. So that's what I'm going to do. So I want to thank everybody here for being here and listening to me. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Mark. I'm an alcoholic. Thanks for having me here tonight. My sobriety date is 10/23/2015. I have a home group and I have a service commitment, which is telling my story to a bunch of teenagers, which seems a lot easier than this for some reason. And there's no microphone. So I tried to write an outline of what I was going to say tonight, and I got about this far. And the only thing that was on it was the highlights of my sobriety. So I'm going to save that for towards the end. I'm just going to start at the beginning. I grew up in a really loving household. I have two younger sisters, and them and my parents, they're all normies. I started going towards the path of my addiction when I was really young, like 11, 12 years old, stealing beers from my friend's parents. And I immediately loved it. It was the early 90s, and grunge was like in full swing. And it seemed like the thing that I wanted to do for the rest of my life. By the time I was like 14, it was dropping acid and drinking pretty much every day, definitely smoking weed every day. And I kept getting in trouble. My parents obviously thought I was going down the wrong path, but I was really stubborn, and I didn't want to listen to anything they said. They would try to ground me, and I would just take off. By the time I was 16, I was gone for 2-3 months at a time, not going to school, getting arrested. And by the time I was 17, I started shooting heroin. And just to give you some perspective, I'm 34 now, and I have a little over a year of sobriety. When I was 17, I also went to my first inpatient treatment. It was a Christian thing called U-Turn for Christ down in Southern California. it was good because it kept me sober for the 8 months that I was there, mostly. But after that, and when I was there, when I first got there, like, I had been basically living on people's couches, sleeping in people's cars, and not had any money, knew that I was going to be either in jail or dead within the next couple of years the way I was living. So when I went there, I was really ready to go there. But after I was there for about a month, I decided that me sticking with the program down there was going to be the quickest way to get back to using the way that I wanted to use. And back then it was just, you know, I want to be able to smoke pot again. Like, that's what I wanted to do. So with that in mind, I finished the program and quickly started smoking pot again. And I managed to keep it, you know, somewhat reasonable until the time I was 21. And when I was 21, like, the party was on. All my friends were 21. It was just going out to the bars. I think within 3 weeks of turning 21, I was drinking every night. And it quickly moved into other drugs. Like, there was a big cocaine section in there. And then I decided that cocaine was making me crazy. So I kind of did the hippie thing, and I went to all the hallucinogens and smoking a bunch of pot. And I'd always kind of go back and forth. You know, I'd notice that I was smoking too much pot, so I'd smoke less pot and drink more. And if I was drinking too much, then I'd start smoking more pot and drink less. So when I was 18, actually when I was in that program, I had a buddy, kind of my road dog from those days. He OD'd and died. So I had told myself I wasn't going to do heroin anymore. By the time I was about 25, I got introduced to Oxycontin. And it was... I convinced myself that it wasn't heroin because it was in a pill form. So, but it smelled just like heroin. So I got going on that, and it was, you know, it was just supplementing my, my other daily drugs at first. And then I met a girl and, got engaged. And I decided that since I was going to be getting married, I should probably, like, do all the Oxycontin I want to do right now. And so then I was, like, immediately strung out. I did Oxycontin every day after that until I started doing heroin again. But I did get married. We had my house that I lived in. We started a business together. And the whole time I was just, like, basically stealing all the money out of the business and basically spent every dime we had. She left, lost the house, lost the business, and ended up living in my house with no running water, no electricity for, like, 9 months. And during this time, I became a thief to support my habit, and stole from strangers, stole from the people I loved, basically stole from anybody. When I finally did lose my house, I was living out of a car, and my this is when I was like 27 or something. My whole family, they tried to have, like, interventions on me, and and I basically just, you know, gave him the finger, and, like, I saw the intervention coming. I could see them all inside the house, and I just split. So they never got to actually do it. And then they kept, like, leaving DVDs on my door of what they would all say at the intervention. And I never watched them. So I finally ran out of gas one day and I called my uncle and he came and gave me some gas and he said, Mark, you know, we all know you're still getting high and we just want you to know there's options. And I really broke down and decided that I needed some help. And I ended up in another year-long Christian program over in Spokane. It was called Teen Challenge. It wasn't just for teenagers. So that I spent, I guess it was the year that I was 29 there. And there was no AA, there was no 12 steps. I'd say the only redeeming characteristic of it was that it kept me sober for the year I was there because I was basically locked up. You know, and it let me know a little bit that I could have fun in sobriety again, because we did have a good time there occasionally. Getting out of there, I met a girl that I knew had some of the same problems I had. And 2 weeks out of that program, I was strung out again. And that basically led into the next two and a half years of my life. And that was when it really started getting bad. I got reintroduced to crack and I spent about a year and a half of that time living in a minivan in my parents' driveway out of the kindness of their heart because they wouldn't let me in the house. And I'll skip over some of it. Towards the end of that time, basically, I pissed off a bunch of drug dealers and, ended up in the hospital. And at that point I was scared and I knew that something had to change. I ended up going to treatment over at Lakeside Milam about a little over 2 years ago. And that was my first real introduction to AA. And the whole, it's like there's a formula for getting sober that I had never been introduced to before. And for me, it was moving into an Oxford house, you know, getting a sponsor, doing the steps, going to meetings. I did the outpatient thing. You know, they told me all these things that I needed to do, and I really wanted to bank the odds in my favor. Like, I was finally seeing people that had actually recovered and meeting them, and these were the things that they had done. Maybe not the outpatient part of it, but it was, Oxford was really convenient because I didn't have any other place to live. So, you know, when I moved into an Oxford house, it was like I had a bunch of instant sober friends and they were people that wanted to go to meetings too. And, you know, at least a few of them were working a program. So I had a really strong desire to stay sober. And yeah, this is 2 years ago. I jumped in head first. I don't know if I did 90 and 90, but I was going to a bunch of meetings. I was going to meetings almost every day and meeting people in the program, making sober friends. And you know, the one piece of advice that I didn't take through treatment that time, that I always make a point of sharing about, cause it was my downfall this last year, was I decided to get into a relationship, after about 4 months, of being sober, like the first time in my life, like I have no idea who I even am. And I wanted to bring somebody else into that shitstorm, you know, like, it's ridiculous, but I did it and, it didn't work out well. You know, and one of the things that, It basically, she was a normie and it started taking me away from the program. I decided I'd rather spend my time with her than going to meetings, than meeting with my sponsor and doing the things that now I know I need to do for my sobriety. So at about 9 months last year, that relationship fell apart, and here I was, not in the center of AA and not well connected. I didn't want to tell anybody about it because I felt like I had failed in sobriety, and it was it was a terrible feeling. I sat around for about 2 days watching Netflix, and then went to work on Monday and packed up about halfway through the day, and I had made my decision, like I was going to go use, and there was nothing anybody could do. And I didn't want to tell anybody because, you know, then they try to stop me naturally. So I did, and it wasn't. Am I out of time? Oh, I was reading it backwards. So, okay, I'll finish really quick. Anyways, I went back to treatment. Got out, have stayed out of relationship this year. And a couple of the real highlights of my sobriety were, you know, my dad called me and said he had a job that he needed help finishing up, and he wasn't going to be able to be there. And instead of showing up 2 hours late and asking for money when I got there, I was there in 5 minutes, and I got to help him finish. Just for Thanksgiving, I got to go pick my grandma up and bring her to Thanksgiving dinner. And, actually just a couple of days before that, my sister's fiance asked me to be in the wedding. And, I call my mom about every other day. I went to church with her this morning, and, those are the gifts that this program has given me. Those are the things that, like, when I think about my sobriety, that really stand out to me. So thanks for letting me share.
Hi, I'm Chuck. I'm an alcoholic. Hey, Chuck. My sobriety date is March 7th. This last March 7th, I had 2 years. And my home group is Burke Avenue Men's Group. I have a sponsor, Greg, and I'm working my way through the steps still. So I thought today, since it's Easter, I'd talk a little bit about spirituality. And I'm going to start reading a little bit from We Agnostics. You've probably heard this a million times, but it always is impactful and really relevant to my sobriety, so hopefully I'll get something from it. Logic is great stuff. We liked it. We still like it. It is not by chance we were given the power to reason, to examine the evidence of our senses, and to draw conclusions. That is one of man's magnificent attributes. We agnostically inclined would not feel satisfied with a proposal which does not lend itself to reasonable approach and interpretation. Hence, we are at pains to tell why we think our present faith is reasonable, why we think it more sane and logical to believe than not to believe, why we say our former thinking was soft and mushy when we threw up our hands in doubt and said, we don't know. When we became alcoholics, crushed by a self-imposed crisis, we could not postpone or evade. We had to fearlessly face the proposition that either God is everything or else he is nothing. God either is or he isn't. What was our choice to be? Arrived at this point, we were squarely confronted with the question of faith. We couldn't duck the issue. Some of us had already walked far over the bridge of reason toward the desired shore of faith. The outlines and the promise of the new land had brought luster to tired eyes and fresh courage to flagging spirits. Friendly hands had stretched out in welcome. We were grateful that reason had brought us so far, but somehow we couldn't quite step ashore. Perhaps we had been leaning too heavily on reason that last mile, and we did not like to lose our support. That was natural, but let us think a little more closely. Without knowing it, had we not been brought to where we stood by a certain kind of faith? For we not believe in our own reasoning? Did we not have confidence in our ability to think? What was that but a sort of faith? Yes, we had been faithful, abjectly faithful, to the God of reason. So in one way or another, we discovered that faith had been involved all the time. We found, too, that we had been worshipers. What a state of mental goose flesh that used to bring on. Had we not variously worshipped people, sentiment, things, money, and ourselves? And then, with a better motive, had we not worshipfully beheld the sunset, the sea, or a flower? Who of us had not loved something or somebody? How much did these feelings, these loves, these worships have to do with pure reason? Little or nothing we saw at last. Were not these things the tissue out of which our lives were constructed? Did not these feelings, after all, determine the course of our existence? It was impossible to say we had no capacity for faith or love or worship. In one form or another, we had been living by faith and little else. Imagine life without faith. Were nothing left but pure reason, it wouldn't be life. But we believed in life, of course we did. We could not prove life in the sense that you can prove a straight line is the shortest distance between two points, yet there it was. Could we still say the whole thing was nothing but a mass of electrons created out of nothing, meaning nothing, whirling onto a destiny of nothingness? Of course we couldn't. The electrons themselves seemed more intelligent than that, at least so the chemist said. Hence we saw that reason isn't everything. Neither is reason, as most of us use it, entirely dependable. Though it emanate from our best minds, what about people who proved that men could never fly? Yet we had been seeing another kind of flight, a spiritual liberation from this world. People who rose above their problems. They say God made these things possible, and we only smiled. We had seen spiritual release, but we liked to tell ourselves it wasn't true. Actually, we were fooling ourselves, for deep down in every man, woman, and child is the fundamental idea of God. It may be obscured by calamity, by pomp, by worship of other things, but in some form or other, it is there. For faith in a power greater than ourselves and miraculous demonstrations of that power in human lives are facts as old as man himself. So that was me. I was your typical cynical guy who didn't believe in religion and in fact was, you know, I like to make fun of it. I like to, you know, pretend that I knew better, to say that people who had faith were stupid, you know, weren't rational, especially those who participated in organized religion. That was the worst kind of all. You know, I was the guy, went to college and I studied science, and then I went on to a career in law, and step by step, I followed what I thought was reason, and, you know, not knowing the entire time that it was self-will. And to a fault, denying that, you know, the existence of a higher power had any sort of effect or positive influence in my life, or could have any positive influence in my life. And I now know that that was a symptom, and that that was part of my disease. And it's taken a long time to come to that understanding, and I'm 2 years into my sobriety, and I still struggle with it, to be quite honest with you. I started out, as I was telling somebody earlier prior to the meeting, in the Pacific group in Southern California. My father was an alcoholic, and my parents were split up. And so what my brother and I got to do when my dad had us on weekends is he would take us to meetings. That was real fun. But so we'd be in the back of these smoke-filled rooms at the time. And there'd be cookies, so we'd have lots of cookies, and we'd point and laugh at all the losers. You know, we'd listen to these stories, and we'd say, how could people be laid so low? You know, that's just ridiculous. And, you know, our own father was a drunk, and, you know, we saw that, and we knew that. But, you know, he was sober at that point, and so wasn't quite on the level of the losers that the other people were in our own minds. But it was with this sort of information that I sort of carried forward into my adult life. And, you know, once I found alcohol, oh boy, you know, it was something different. And, you know, I should have known probably, and I think I did on a lot of levels, that I was, at all times that I was going to be an alcoholic. But when you're young, you know, when you're in your 20s and you're going strong, it's not necessarily the problem that it becomes later in life. And that was the case for me. In my case, I drank to make myself comfortable, to make friends, to feel like I belonged. And that worked in high school, and that really worked in college. When I went to college, I went to WSU. That's the major leagues of drinking. And followed all my friends there and had this peer group of drinkers to, you know, sustain me and to carry along. And that's what I did. You know, I didn't go to college to study. I went to college to drink. I'm looking back on this now and figuring this all out. And it worked. And I was somehow able to carry through and get a good enough grade point average that I wasn't thrown out of there. But that's what I did. I drank. And all this time, you know, I still maintain that cynicism. And I didn't have any sort of prayer. I didn't have any sort of meditation. I didn't have any sort of respect for any sort of higher power other than just drinking and logic and reason according to my own mind. And this went on, you know, through college and into law school even. And I even drank all the way through law school and somehow still made it through based on my own reasoning. I thought I was smarter than everybody else, so that's how I was able to accomplish all this. You know, I was able to drink, but blackout drunk, you know, two times a night, sometimes three times, two times a week, sometimes three times a week while I was studying for finals even. I was able to carry through because I had this reason, you know. I had this this brain that was smarter than everybody else in the room. So that's what I did, and that worked until it didn't. And when it didn't start, when it started not working, it really started not working. I got married, I had two kids, and I had a practice. I was a partner in a law firm, and I drank it all away. It's really that simple. I mean, I could spin it any different number of ways, but I started drinking by myself. I started drinking in the basement alone because when I drank with other people, it wasn't, you know, they couldn't keep up with me, so it wasn't worth the time. In fact, I got to a point where I wouldn't even drink if I went out because it was like a farce drinking with other people because they didn't drink the same way I did. They drink, you know, they would have a glass of wine or enjoy themselves or, you know, be at a cocktail party and be social. And I'd be thinking the whole time, when can I get out of here so I can really start drinking? And that's when I would go home and retire to the basement and or figure out a project in the garage. And that's where I would drink. And I would drink until I blacked out almost every night. And this went on for about 2 years. My law practice eventually fell apart. And I was kicked out of my firm as a partner. And stayed on as what they call of counsel, which meant I get to be home by myself, associated with the firm still. But, hey, that's more time to drink. So I started drinking earlier and earlier in the day. And this went on, and until one day, one night, I found myself in my basement alone, had been drinking for hours and hours, just completely out of my mind drunk. And I was looking at my life insurance policy and using my legal mind and my reason and trying to figure out if I could kill myself and still collect. And that's sort of my aha moment. That's when I figured out this has to stop. I got to do something about this. And I was fortunate enough to have some good friends in the program. And I called them and they took me to a meeting the next day. And I've had a relapse since then. That time, that was about 2.5 years ago, so I had about 6 months into it, and I had a relapse. But as I said, I have 2 years now, and I've lost a lot. And I've lost my integrity. As I said, I lost my law practice. I've had to give it up and move on to another career. But I'm sober, and I've found some measure of a higher power. And for me, the higher power is my home group. It's my sponsor. It's sort of the collective consciousness of the group and AA in general. And it's full circle. You know, I've come full circle since sitting in those rooms and pointing at what I thought were losers and realizing now that those were just me. Those were folks just like I was. I am. And I guess I should be humbled by that. And I am in a certain sense, but I'm also proud to be among those people that I once scorned, and I'm proud to be amongst you, and I thank you for your time, and thanks for listening to my story.
Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Sobercast is ad-free, and we'd like your help in order to keep it that way. So if you'd like to help us be self-supporting by pledging $1 or $2 a month, visit Sobercast.com and look for the donate links. Thank you very much.